and testinclassics.com. Go to classics.com, click on practice. So you will find a lot of packages. You can select any package. Now I'm going to select NEET Premium package. And then you will see NEET Premium has four test series, physics, chemistry, biology, and NEET full test. Under biology, the tests are arranged chapter wise, and you will find a lot of bubbles here. Each bubble is a test. Now, if you look at the green bubble, it means you have taken the test and you can visit any number of times. Suppose you have scored little less marks, you want to revisit to see whether you are able to understand the concept and attempt it, you can do it. Or if you want for revision sake, you can again visit the test and redo the test. Blue bubble indicates that you have not taken the test yet and it's a reminder that you need to take it. Yellow bubble here shows that you have not completed the test. It might be possible that you have taken the test. After three or four questions, you would feel that you are not really ready for the test, as a result of which you might discontinue the test, and hence it's showing you incomplete status in yellow color. Now, when you have completed all the levels of test, this red bubble is a randomized test wherein it is going to pick up the questions from all these tests in a random fashion to test whether you are able to. These tests are all done in such a way that depending upon the complexity of the lesson and its importance in NEET, taking that into consideration, these tests are being done. I hope you got to know how to navigate to the website. So in today's class, I will be revising the key concepts, do a practice test based on the concepts learned, and in the end, I shall answer your questions. Now you will also find there is a bubble revision notes. When you click on it, it will take you to the revision notes. Now before we begin this, you all might be, the exams are around the corner. You might be a little bit apprehensive about how NEET papers are going to be. From our experience, we have seen that there are three main types of questions. One is NCERT based. Approximately 68 to 70 questions in the examination are directly from NCERT books. They can be attempted easily by those who read NCERT syllabus very religiously. And for you to help that to get in between the lines, the tests have been designed in this package. Now, direct from the previous year's question paper, another 8 to 10 questions in the examination can be solved if you have solved NEET question papers of previous years. These questions are repeated with little or no modifications. And the last one will be the modified question. 8 to 10 questions in the NEET will always be newer questions. These questions become the game changer for those, as these can't be solved by mere mugging up of facts. Though they are from NCERT book, to get them right, you need to apply the knowledge so that you are able to get marks out of these from these questions. And in this website, an earnest attempt has been made to help you prepare adequately for your NEET. Now, I hope you got the framework. Now, let us begin with the lesson. Now, as I said, let us have, when you click on this button, it opens into the revision notes. And these revision notes are framed in such a way that you are able to get everything in a jiffy so that you are able to prepare and revise in the last minute very easily. And all the key points have been captured either in the form of tables or some graphic organizers and with key definitions and key formula. And I would suggest that this would be an ideal package for you to add an asset for your preparation. Now let us look into breathing and exchange of gases. Now respiration, it is an oxidative process involving the oxidation of food substances such as carbohydrates, fats and proteins within the tissues to form carbon dioxide, water and consequent release of energy. The released energy is temporarily stored as ATP. Now let us look at types of respiration. One is aerobic respiration, the other is anaerobic respiration. When food is oxidized without using molecular oxygen, the respiration is called anaerobic respiration. Example, anaerobic bacteria, yeast, parasitic worms like Ascaris, Tinea, Fasciola, etc. In microorganisms, the term fermentation is more commonly used in place of anaerobic respiration, which is defined as the anaerobic breakdown of carbohydrates and other organic compounds into alcohols, organic acids, gases, etc., with the help of microorganisms or their enzymes. Aerobic respiration, when oxygen is used for respiration, it is called aerobic respiration, and this is most commonly seen in plants and animals. In higher animals, whole process of respiration includes external respiration, internal respiration, and cellular respiration. Now let us look at mechanism of breathing. It can be broadly divided into external respiration and internal respiration. Now let us know in brief about external respiration. It is the process by which gases are exchanged between the blood and the air. It is a physical process. It is simply the intake of oxygen and giving out of carbon dioxide. Now respiratory movements involve two phases. One is the inspiration, other is the expiration. In inspiration, it's a process by which fresh air enters in the lungs. In this, diaphragm becomes flat and gets lowered by the contraction of its muscle fibers and increases the volume of the thoracic cavity. The external intercostal muscles contract and pull the ribs and the sternum upwards and outwards direction, and thus the volume of thoracic cavity is increased. In expiration, the opposite happens, as a result of which the volume reduces and pressure increases and air is pushed out of the lungs. In the internal respiration, it is the process by which gases are exchanged between blood and tissue fluid and between tissue fluid and the cells. Now, cellular respiration is the process by which cells use oxygen for metabolism and give out carbon dioxide as the waste. Now, this slide is very important, children, because in the previous exams, they have asked you what are the respiratory organs. So, let us have a look. In reptiles and mammals, chief respiratory organs are lungs. In frog, earthworm, and leeches, skin acts as the respiratory organ. Gills are the respiratory organs in fishes, tadpoles, and prawns. Trachea are the respiratory organs seen in insects, centipedes, and millipedes. Protozoa, porifera, and coelenterata have their general body surface as a respiratory organ, as they are simple-celled organisms by gaseous exchange. Through diffusion, gaseous exchange occurs through the body surface. Scorpions, ticks, and mites have book lungs. King crab, prawn, crayfish, and daphnia have book gills as their respiratory organs. Lungfish and bony fish have air bladder as the respiratory organ. And in birds, it is the air sac or the lungs. So I'll give you 2 minutes time. Please make a note of this. This is very important. Okay, now let me start with human respiratory system. This diagram is very important. You need to know the parts. This is epiglottis, this is larynx, the ring-like structure supported by cartilage is the trachea, this long thing is the bronchus, and this bronchus will divide into bronchi entering into left lung and the right lung, and inside it will break into branches called a bronchiole. And at the tip of the bronchioles, you will find the alveoli. These are the pleural membranes that surround the lungs, and this is the pleural fluid. So you have to learn this diagram and also the labeling. It is very important from exam point of view, where they might ask you to identify the parts or relate it with the function of the parts given. Now, human respiratory system, structurally and functionally, the conducting part of human respiratory system is highly complicated. The respiratory system is derived from embryonic endoderm. The mammalian respiratory system consists of two groups. One is the respiratory tract and other is the respiratory organ. Now, different types of respiratory tracts are as follows. Now, let us look into the nostrils. Holes of the nose are called nostrils. These are paired openings that open up into the nasal chamber. Nasal cavity is divided into nasal chamber by the nasal septum. Each nasal chamber consists of three regions: vestibular, respiratory, and olfactory regions. Larynx contains vocal cords, the sound producing elastic fibers called voice box. There is a little difference in the size of the larynx in man and woman. It grows larger and becomes more prominent in man, and then it is called Adam's apple. Human larynx consists of glottis, cartilages, hyoid bone, thyrohyoid membrane, vocal cords, laryngeal ligaments, and muscles. Glottis is an opening in the floor of pharynx leading to the larynx. There are 9 pieces of cartilages, which are 3 are single and 3 are paired. Epiglottis is a leaf-like structure that prevents the entry of the food into the respiratory tract during swallowing. Now trachea. Trachea or the windpipe is a continuation of the larynx. Trachea is supported by incomplete rings of hyaline cartilage. The mucosa of trachea is lined with a ciliated pseudostratified epithelium containing mucus secreting goblet cells, which helps in pushing the mucus out. Bronchi, these are one pair of small thin-walled tubular structure formed by a division of trachea at the level of the 5th thoracic vertebrae. Now let us look into the respiratory organs, lungs. Each lung is covered by a double membrane and it is called as the pleura. The outer covering membrane of the lung is called parietal pleura. The inner covering membrane of the lung is called visceral pleura. In human, the right lung has 3 lobes and left lung has got 2 lobes. Alveoli. Alveoli are the ultimate structural and physiological units of the lung. These provide great surface area for gaseous exchange by diffusion. Gaseous exchange occurs across the respiratory membrane of the alveoli. Bronchiole, the tertiary bronchi subdivides into smaller branches, and these branches are called the bronchioles. After repeated branching, one of the smaller bronchioles enter a lung lobule called as the lobular bronchiole. Now there is a diaphragm. So this is very, very important. This dome-shaped structure, what you see is the diaphragm. Diaphragm separates the thoracic cavity from the abdominal cavity. Diaphragm is the characteristic of mammals. Diaphragm is supplied by the phrenic nerves. Puncturing of the diaphragm will result in stoppage of breathing, and it is very, very fatal. Now, I hope you have understood the respiratory system. Now, let us look into steps of respiration. So, these are the 5 steps: breathing or pulmonary ventilation, diffusion of gases across the alveolar membrane, transport of gases by the blood, diffusion of gases by of oxygen and carbon dioxide between the blood and the tissues, utilization of oxygen, and release of carbon dioxide. So these are the main steps. Now let us look into mechanism of respiration. So here you're seeing the inhalation and here you're seeing the exhalation. So this diagram you have to look and observe carefully. So if the lung, that is the lung volume has increased, if the volume of the thorax has increased, then it means it is inspiration. If the volume of the thorax is decreased, then it is exhalation. So this you have to understand, and you should also look for the diaphragm. Here you see the diaphragm is contracted, and here you find the diaphragm is relaxed and has assumed a dome shape. Here it is almost flattened. So these diagrams, when they ask you to identify, please look out for these clues. One is the diaphragm, whether it is dome shaped or it is almost flat. If it is flat, it is inhalation. If it is dome shaped, it is exhalation. And then look for the lung thoracic cavity. If the volume of the thorax seems to be more, then it is inspiration. When it is less, it is expiration or exhalation. So these are the things, clues you have to observe in the diagram when a question has been asked. Now let us look at the mechanism of respiration. Inspiration is brought about by diaphragm muscles and external intercostal muscles. These muscles are therefore called inspiratory muscles. The abdominal muscles play a passive role in this when the external intercostal muscles contract and pull the rib cage upwards and outwards away from the spinal cord. At the same time, diaphragm contracts and flattens. These movements increases the volume and therefore lower the pressure in the thorax. So you know, when the volume increases, pressure decreases. As the pressure in the pharynx falls below that of atmospheric air, now air is pushed into the lungs to equalize the pressure. Abdominal muscles relax and allow compression of abdominal organs by the diaphragm. Now, expiration is a passive process as it simply involves relaxation of inspiratory muscles. It is brought about by the relaxation of the muscles of diaphragm and external intercostal muscles. The ribs fall back to the resting position of and diaphragm assumes a dome shape. Volume of the lungs decrease and hence pressure increases, forcing out carbon dioxide. The abdominal and intercostal muscles are called expiratory muscles. Now, this is about the mechanism of respiration. Now, let us look at Now, these are the respiratory volumes and capacities. This is very, very important. You have to know this. One is tidal volume. So, the respiratory volumes, if you look at it, the quantities of air that lung can receive, hold or expel under different conditions are called pulmonary or respiratory volumes. And combination of two or more pulmonary volumes are called pulmonary capacities. Now, let us look into this tidal volume. Volume of the air inspired or expired during a normal respiration. It is approximately 500 ml. A healthy person can expire or inspire approximately 6000 to 8000 ml of air per minute. Inspiratory reserve volume. Additional volume of air. A person can inspire by forcible inspiration. This averages to 2500 ml to 3000 ml. Expiratory reserve volume, additional volume of air. A person can expire by forcible expiration. And this averages to 1000 to 1100 ml. Residual volume, volume of air remaining in the lungs even after forcible expiration. And this averages to 1100 to 1200 ml. These values are very, very important. Please make a note of it and learn it. Now you have inspiratory capacity. Total volume of air a person can inspire after a normal expiration. This includes TV and IRV. Now next one is expiratory capacity. Total volume of air a person can expire after a normal inspiration. This includes tidal volume and expiratory reserve. So that will be equal to 1600 to 1900 ml. Functional residual capacity is the volume of air that will remain in the lungs after a normal expiration. This includes ERV plus RV, that is 2100 to 2300 ml. Vital capacity, the maximum volume of air a person can breathe in after a forced expiration. This includes ERV, TV and IRV, or maximum volume of air a person can breathe out after a forced inspiration. Total lung capacity, total volume of air accommodated in the lungs at the end of a forced inspiration. This includes RV, ERV, TV and IRV, or vital capacity and residual volume. To help you out to remember this, there is a slide which is going to tell you total lung capacity is TV plus IRV plus ERV plus RV. VC is equal to TV plus IRV plus ERV. IC is equal to TV plus IRV. FRC is equal to ERV plus RV. So make a note of these things. TLC is total lung capacity. VC is vital capacity, IC is inspirational capacity or inspiratory capacity, and FRC is functional residual capacity. Please make a note of this. This is very important, and also the values. So the values are already there in the PDF. Now let us look at exchange of gases. Now breathing or pulmonary ventilation is the process of moving air into and out of the lungs. Now pulmonary gas exchange, you know, alveoli are the primary sites of exchange of gases. Exchange of gases also occur between blood and tissues. Solubility of gas as well as thickness of the membranes involved in diffusion are important factors that can affect the rate of diffusion. And partial pressures of oxygen and carbon dioxide in the atmospheric air and the two sites of diffusion play a very crucial role. As the solubility of carbon dioxide is 20 to 25 times higher than that of oxygen, amount of carbon dioxide that can diffuse through the diffusion membrane per unit difference in partial pressure is much higher compared to that of oxygen. Now let us look, this diagram is important, where they might ask you to what is the value and what does it show. Now section of an alveolus, if you look at it, the diffusion membrane is made up of three layers, thin squamous epithelium of alveoli, the endothelium of alveolar capillaries, and the basement substance in between them. All these factors are favorable for diffusion of oxygen from alveoli to tissues and that of carbon dioxide from tissues to alveoli. If we had to summarize this, we can just say that how it happens means, so physiology, exchange of gases takes place from the region of higher partial pressure to lower partial pressure. Here, partial pressure of oxygen in the alveolar air is 104 mm of mercury. Partial pressure of oxygen in venous blood is 40 mm of mercury. So oxygen has from higher concentration to lower concentration. So from the alveoli to venous blood, oxygen diffuses. Similarly, partial pressure of carbon dioxide in venous blood is 45 mm of mercury. Partial pressure of carbon dioxide in the alveolar air is 40 mm of mercury. So carbon dioxide diffuses from the venous blood to the alveoli. And now let us look into oxygen transport. So blood transports oxygen from the respiratory organs to the tissue cells and also transports carbon dioxide from the tissue cells to the respiratory membrane. Now if you look at oxygen transport, 98.5% of oxygen is transported by blood with the help of respiratory pigment hemoglobin present in erythrocytes. One molecule of hemoglobin can carry as much as 4 oxygen molecules. 1 gram of hemoglobin binds to about 1.34 ml of oxygen. Thus, if you take 100 ml of pure blood, it will be carrying 20 ml of oxygen. So if there are any calculations to be made, you please remember, for every 100 ml of pure blood, it will be carrying 20 ml of pure oxygen, 20 ml of oxygen. Now this is the oxygen dissociation curve. When a graph is plotted between percent saturation of hemoglobin and oxygen tension, a curve is obtained, which is termed as hemoglobin-oxygen dissociation curve. But here you are going to see the oxygen dissociation curve that is given in your textbook. And this is also very important. They might ask you to identify the curve or identify what is there on the x-axis and what is there on the y-axis. At normal conditions, that is on PCO2 of 40 mm mercury concentration, this curve is sigmoid and normal. Due to the increase in the concentration of carbon dioxide, curve will be shifted towards the right side. Due to decrease in the concentration of carbon dioxide, curve will be shifting towards more towards the left side. Now let us look into carbon dioxide transport. Transport of carbon dioxide by blood is much easier than that of oxygen due to high solubility of carbon dioxide in water. About 7% of carbon dioxide is transported as dissolved in plasma, 23% as carbaminohemoglobin and 70% as bicarbonate. Most of the carbonate, carbon dioxide is transported by the blood in the form of sodium bicarbonate in the plasma. Now, with this, you will also have to learn something more that is beyond your text. There are 3 effects. One is the Bose effect. Hemoglobin oxygen dissociation curve shifts to the right when carbon dioxide tension in the blood is high. Bose effect was discovered by Bohr in 1904. Deoxygenation of oxyhemoglobin is directly proportional to the blood partial pressure of carbon dioxide of the tissue fluid, and alveoli does not exert Bohr's effect. Now let us look into carbon. Now let us see the next effect, that is Hamburg. This is also very important. To maintain electrostatic neutrality of plasma, many chloride ions diffuse from plasma into RBC and bicarbonate ions will pass out. The chloride content of RBCs increase when oxygenated blood becomes deoxygenated, and this is termed as chloride shift or Hamburger shift, and it is named after the person who discovered. Now the last effect you have is the Haldane's effect. Oxyhemoglobin will behave as a strong acid. As more and more oxyhemoglobin forms in the lungs, it releases more and more H plus ions, increasing the acidity of the blood. This is Haldane's effect, and this is very important. Now let us get back to other concepts here. Now, how is respiration regulated? Respiratory movements are under the control of medulla oblongata. The basic rhythm of respiration is controlled by the respiratory center, which is present in the brainstem, that is medulla and the pons. The basic rhythm of the inhalation is controlled by medulla and the pons. The medullary rhythmic area can be divided into dorsal respiratory group, that is DRG, and a ventral respiratory group, VRG. The receptors for chemical regulation are located in the carotid bodies, aortic bodies, and in the brain. Carotid and aortic bodies are association with the heart. Carotid and aortic bodies are responsible for the detection of oxygen concentration in the blood and its effect on the breathing. These are considered as peripheral chemoreceptors. Thus, blood oxygen does not have direct effect on the respiratory center of the brain. Along with nervous and coordination, temperature also affects breathing rate. So there is another thing which is also called as pneumotaxis center in the pons region, as I said, moderate the function of the respiratory rhythm center. Neural signals from pneumotaxis center can reduce the duration of inspiration and thereby alter the respiratory rate. A chemosensitive area which is situated adjacent to the rhythm center is highly sensitive to carbon dioxide and H plus ions. An increase in CO2 and H plus will trigger the chemosensitive area, which in turn will activate the respiratory rhythm center to make arrangements for their elimination. Now, these receptors, as I said, are associated with aortic arc and carotid artery, which recognize and changes in carbon dioxide and H plus concentration. In addition, they will send signals to rhythm center. Oxygen has now, again I'm repeating, they might ask you, does oxygen have any role, or which one of the following do not have any role? Please remember, it is oxygen has an insignificant role in the regulation of the rhythm center. Now let us look into the disorders of respiratory system. We have gone slightly above the text, looking into the kind of questions that are being asked in the exam. Now one is asthma. Difficulty in breathing causing wheezing due to inflammation of bronchi and bronchioles. Emphysema is a chronic disorder in which alveolar walls are damaged, due to which respiratory surface is decreased, and as a result, the gaseous exchange will not take place efficiently. Cigarette smoking is the main cause, because the tobacco will go and block the alveolus. Now, occupational respiratory disorders. So, you know, this is related to the diseases that arise due to overexposure. So if you look at marble industries, or if you look at asbestos industries, all there people will be subjected to prolonged fine dust that will finally get into the lungs. They block the alveolus, as a result of which it results in decreased efficiency of gaseous exchange. So now silicosis. It is caused by clay, sand, and stone grinding. Silica particles first become irritants and then form fibrosis. And finally, a lump of fibrosis will be formed in the lungs. Asbestosis is caused by inhaling of asbestos inside the respiratory tract. carbon monoxide poisoning caused by excess of carbon monoxide in the inhaled air. Carbon monoxide will decrease oxygen carrying capacity because carbon dioxide will go and combine with hemoglobin to form carboxyhemoglobin, as a result of which you will feel dizzy, headache, palpitation, and finally it might lead to death. Oxides of sulfur cause suffocation and irritation in the upper respiratory tract. When you have prolonged exposure to the oxides of sulfur, will result in chronic asthma and bronchitis. Hypoxia, oxygen deficiency in body tissues. Artificial hypoxia is shortage of oxygen in the air at higher altitudes, and this causes mountain sickness, causes headaches, breathlessness, dizziness, nausea, vomiting, and your skin will start appearing bluish, and even your mucous membranes of the skin will start appearing blue. But this altitude sickness can be overcome when you are staying there for some time. Your body will automatically start getting itself adapted, and then things will return to normal. Now, histotaxic hypoxia is cyanide poisoning. Cyanides inactivate cytochrome oxidase enzyme or electron transport chain. Asphyxia is due to oxygen deficiency and accumulation of carbon dioxide in the body tissues. Excess of carbon monoxide will paralyze the respiratory center. It will stop breathing, resulting in death. Pleura is the membrane of the lung. And inflammation of the pleural sac due to increased formation of pleural fluid results in pleurisy. It may arise as a secondary problem due to liver problem, pneumonia, viral infections, tuberculosis, blockage of lymph and blood vessels, etc. Laryngitis, it is inflammation of larynx and vocal cords. It is characterized by hoarseness, cough, and difficulty in swallowing. Inflammation of the pharynx. It is characterized by sore throat and caused by viral and bacterial infections. Bronchitis, hypertrophy of the serum mucus gland and goblet cells of bronchi, which results to regular coughing with greenish yellow sputum. It is also caused by bacterial or viral infections, smoking, and air pollutants. See, itis refers to inflammation. Any word, if you look at it ending with itis, it is an inflammation, and usually it will be associated with the organ. So when you are able to identify the organ, that organ is getting inflamed, that is the disorder of the particular organ. So with this, we are completing the key concepts of the lesson. Now let us look into the test. Now, regarding inspiration, choose the incorrect statement. So, as I said, now let us look into the statement. Have a look at the choices. It is the contraction of intercostal muscles lifts up the ribs and the sternum, causing an increase in the volume of the thoracic chamber in the dorsoventral axis. So this is the incorrect statement. Sorry, let us look into second question. So after regarding expiration, choose the incorrect statement. So, relaxation of the diaphragm and intercostal muscles. Increase the thoracic volume. Now, this is the diagram. In alveolar and blood and tissue gas exchanges, what are the values of X1, Y1, x2y2, x3y3 in the picture marked. So I told you this diagram is very important. This they might ask you. So x1, y1 is 40, 45. y1, x2, y2 will be equal to 104, 40. x3, y3 will be 95, 40. So these things you should have at your fingertips. Now identify the structures marked as A, B, C and D in order, and also specify what A, B, C constitute in the picture. Choose the appropriate statement. Alveolar wall, basement substance, endothelium of alveolar capillaries, red blood cells, ABC constitute the diffusion membranes. Identify the enzyme. Where X, where is it present? Every 100 ml of deoxygenated blood delivers approximately dash ml of carbon dioxide to the alveoli. Now let us look into it. Choices. Minute quantities of are present in the plasma. So carbonic anhydrase. RBCs contain a very high concentration. So every 100 ml of deoxygenated blood delivers approximately 4 ml of carbon dioxide to the alveoli. Now this is multiple matching. We have to look into that. If you look at asthma, it is inflammation of bronchi and bronchioles. Okay, so A will be equal to 4. So there is nothing in 1 and 2 to list for asthma. A can be equal to 4. So then B is equal to 1 and 1. So B is emphysema. It is due to cigarette smoking. Alveolar walls are damaged. And respiratory surface is decreased. So is the right answer. Regarding human respiratory system, incorrect one. Each terminal bronchiole gives rise to a number of very thin, irregular walled and non-vascular bags. Actually, they are vascular bag-like structures called alveoli. So that is the incorrect one. Now let us look at the 8th question. Humans have 2 lungs which are covered by double-layered pleura with pleural fluid between them, right? Pleural fluid is... So regarding this, both are correct. Sorry. Let me see. What did I say? Both are correct. Okay. Now breathing involves 2 stages. Inspiration by which is drawn in and expiration by which alveolar air is released out. One is correct. The movement of air into and out of the lungs is independent of the pressure gradient between the lungs and the atmosphere. 2 is wrong because it is dependent on the pressure gradient and that is why diffusion occurs. So 1 is correct but 2 is incorrect. Choose the correct statements regarding inspiration and expiration. Choose the correct statement. All are correct. Humans have the ability to increase the strength of inspiration and expiration with the help of additional muscles in the abdomen. True. On an average, a healthy human breathes 12 to 16 times per minute. Now both are correct. The volume of air involved in breathing movements can be estimated by using spirometer, which helps in clinical assessment of pulmonary functions. Respiratory volume of respiratory volumes, tidal volume, volume of air inspired or expired during a normal respiration. That is right. It is approximately 500 ml. That is, a healthy man can inspire or expire approximately 600 to 800 ml of air per minute. Now, one is correct, but two is incorrect. Inspiratory reserve volume, additional volume of air. A person can inspire by a forcible inspiration. Expiratory reserve volume, additional volume of air. A person can expire by forcible expiration. Now, regarding 1 and 2, both are correct. Sorry. IRV averages from dash and expiratory reserve volume, ERV averages from dash respectively. It is 2500 ml to 3000 ml and 1000 ml to 1100 ml. So that's why I said these values you have to memorize it. Respiratory volume, residual volume is to volume of air this averages from. So it is remaining in the lungs even after forcible expiration, and its value is 1100 ml to 1200 ml. Inspiratory capacity is dash and it includes dash. Total volume a person can inspire after a normal expiration, it includes tidal volume and inspiratory reserve volume. So total volume of air a person can inspire after a normal expiration, tidal volume and inspiratory reserve volume. So D is the answer. Expiratory capacity, total volume of air a person can expire after a forced inspiration. That is wrong. It includes tidal volume and expiratory reserve volume. One is incorrect, but two is correct. Functional residual capacity, regarding this we had to see volume of air that will remain in the lungs after a normal expiration. True. This includes ERV plus RV. Regarding 1 and 2, both are correct. Concentration gradient for oxygen is from tissues to blood and blood to alveoli. Concentration gradient is present for carbon dioxide from alveoli to blood and blood to tissues. Now, if you look at it, both are incorrect. Now, I am completing the test. So here, all the things are correct, all the answers are correct. So this completes, this shows that our answers are correct. Suppose if it was a wrong answer, I would have got a red indicator. And if I click on that, then an explanation will be given. Your answer and the correct answer will also be highlighted so that you realize your mistake and explanations are also given. If you have not attempted, it will appear in this yellow color legend. That means, you see, it's better because if you do not know the answer, don't try to guess the answer. Make a wild guess because you will be losing one mark from your total marks. That is better if you are not sure of the answer, not to attempt it. But here, when you click on this, you will be able to get to know the answer correctly. So this completes today's class. So look at it. Note that NEET packages, here if you look into our pages, you will have three full hour tests with 15 original tests and 20 plus past NEET papers. All are solved with solutions. If you want additional help, you can ask use our ask feature and support chat group using Telegram. You can also book slots for one-to-one teaching with the tutors for any lesson which you feel you need a help, especially. And for any inquiries, you can mail your query to info@play6.com. Thank you.